We heard about the Statue of Liberty from someone who was involved with the project. Later today, we'll tell you how you can send in your story ideas and win an Action News for Kids t-shirt.
With all the interest in trivia games lately, it's important to stay up on top of things. Did you know that the real Statue of Liberty in New York Harbor was a gift from the people of France, or that there are 168 steps inside? Instead of paper mache, it's made of copper, and it was brand new. It was the color of a penny. The salt air of the harbor is responsible for fading it to pale green.
If that last story caught your interest, in the coming weeks, keep your eyes open for our half-hour special on kiting. It's called Flying Kites, Holding Hands with the Wind, and it'll be airing sometime in May. Don't forget, the zoo will open for its summer season starting April 29th. Until then, you can visit the zoo on weekends only, from 10 to 5. And, in addition to the zoo's new weekday hours, here are a few more noteworthy events that may interest you.
On Sunday, April 14th at 3 o'clock, the Waterman Conservation Center will sponsor a Signs of Spring Seasons hike. Come along and celebrate with us. Or learn about the constellations of spring at the Roberson Planetarium. You can see the newest star show called Soft Spring of Evening on Friday, April 19th and 26th. At 7:30 p.m.
Fish garment. And we'll meet a circus lover who's found a way to enjoy the circus every day. I'm Monica Van Wert, and I'll have these stories and more for you.
Today is our last show of the season, and we'll get a head start on summer with a visit to a local vacation spot. We'll also look at some of the bloopers we've made in the past year. I'm Rebecca Rosenberg, and we have a great show for you today.
Gurney's Magic Circus is located on Tiona Road off of Route 26 in the town of Maine. Farm animals may not be as entertaining or unusual as the circus animals we just saw, but they do help us out in other ways. At Itasca Valley Farm in Whitney Point, sheep are raised for their wool. What makes this sheep farm different from most of the rest is that the whole wool-making process is done by hand, right on the farm, up to the finished clothing. School is finally out, and summer vacation is finally here. We're going off the air for the summer, so we wanted to spend part of this last show on a little bit of summer fun. A day at a local vacation resort gave us a chance to do something from swimming, boating, and golfing, and to get a head start on the rest of the summer.
Scatsaquaga Lake House is located off Route 17 near the town of Deposit. We had a great time and hope that your summer vacation will be full of fun too.
We've all had lots of fun working on the show this season, and some of the funniest moments were totally unplanned. Stay tuned for a look at some of our own Action News for Kids bloopers.
Working on the show this season has really been a lot of fun. We've had a chance to meet people and go places and do things but we might have never done otherwise. But some of the funniest moments that we got on tape weren't even planned, and we're going to take a look at some of them now.
When we all started out at the beginning of the season, one of the first things we had to learn to do was something called a stand-up. It usually takes place at the introduction or conclusion of a story, and it involves memorizing two or three sentences. Then we just have to stand up in front of the camera and say them. Sounds pretty easy, right? Well, not always.
When the turkeys leave their pen for the last time, eventually they'll end up in nice, neat stacks in this cooler. When the turkeys leave their pen for the last time, eventually they'll end up in nice, neat stacks.
Think about what you're saying, Bethany.
This is what we think of flies.
Start again.
Stand by. smack it, start talking, just keep this thing down. Don't wave it around like that, okay?
But who looks after a injured squirrel or orphaned raccoon? One of the lesser-known projects at the Ross Park Zoo concerns wildlife rehabilitation.
I don't think I ever got a round of applause like that for one of my stand-ups. We learned to do what was called interviewing. The interview itself usually wasn't too difficult, but we all hated what came afterwards, cutaway questions. During the interview, the camera person always had the camera focused on the person answering the questions. So right afterwards, we had to move the camera around so it's focused on the reporter. And the reporter has to ask those same questions again in front of the camera, even though no one will answer them. This is done to give the editor plenty of choices when the story is being edited together, but it can really make you feel silly sometimes.
Do you have any more experiments planned?
Do that again, I had his nose in the
shot. Do you have more?
Now before you start.
Woo! Okay, I'm cold. I can't do this. Do you have more experiments planned?
Yes.
What is a bird of prey? Are they native to... What are their migration patterns? I know, but she's making me laugh. She's smiling.
Some have asked me questions and I don't get to answer.
Okay. Do they have names? How old are the baby monkeys? How long will the mothers provide food for the babies?
18 years.
Good job, Rebecca. Right from my very first experience, which you'll see a bit of, I learned that you just never know what will happen on a shoot. From lighting problems to a guest with a sense of humor that just won't quit. I just don't know why that happened to me more than anyone else.
How are the rubbings made?
Well, by using a very thin, but... Don't blame me, I didn't do it. You get a thin piece of paper that's Terry's...
His name is Mr. Paul Myers, and after 3.5 years,
That's what I said.
Sorry.
3.5. I'll have my assistant kill that fly. Trees.
Can you tell us about some of the pictures you took?
No, I don't think it's any of your business.
Okay. Can you tell them?
Is this your first one?
Yes.
I'm sorry. I didn't mean to mess up your first one. All the rest will be easy.
Well, I think after that one, all the rest were easy. Anyway, we survived the season, and this is probably the best time to give a special thanks to our camera person and editor, Denise Gorman. She really did have a good sense of humor when things weren't going so well. We're almost out of time for today. As we've said before, this is our last show for the season, but be sure to be watching for us again in September. And in the meanwhile, don't forget about us. We'll still be looking for story ideas. So if you know something interesting or unusual, drop us a line. Write to us at Action News for Kids, WBNG-TV, Box 1200, Binghamton, New York, 13902. If we use your story on the air, we'll send you an Action News for Kids t-shirt.
Until we see you again, Have a safe summer and a happy one. We hope you all have fun.
Classroom where Broome County kids go through the school day with a smiling grandma for company. I'm Monica Van Wert.
And I'm Kurt Milligan. We'll also see a collection of dolls from all over the world. These stories and more are coming right up, so stay with us.
Raggedy Ann, Barbie, and the Cabbage Patch Kids are like old friends to many of us. We'd recognize them anywhere, but in other parts of the world, dolls have a whole different look, and they can tell us a lot about the people who made them. We'll take a look at the costumes that dolls wear all over the world and see some American dolls from the past and present.
A doll is a toy with a character of its own, like the Campbell Kids here. And here at the Robertson Center, many dolls from all over the world are on display.
From this Russian soldier to the matadors of Spain, all kinds of traditional costumes can be seen here. But not every type of national dress is so easily recognized. This troll doll is good luck in Scandinavia. And in real life, this style of ceremonial dress was so heavy that the African chief who wore it had to be assisted by three of his warriors. In Japan, a traditional hairstyle is assigned to certain time periods in a girl's life. This doll comes with a collection of wigs. Catherine Schwefferman is the curator of this exhibit.
How are the dolls a reflection of the people and places they came from?
You look at some of the dolls, particularly in the ethnic kaleidoscope exhibit, and you see the kinds of clothes that they wear. You also see the color of their skin. You see their height, how tall they are, and this all reflects a little bit about the culture that they come from or the area of the world that they come from. Certainly their manner of dress will tell you whether or not the climate is cold or if it's hot, that sort of thing.
Through the years, the faces of many well-known people have been models for dolls. Gandhi was an Indian leader, and this doll dates back to 1948. The American dolls in the collection also feature a few famous faces like George and Martha Washington and Shirley Temple. These dolls were all made in the 1930s. The Dion Quintuplets were a set of famous babies that also inspired doll makers. Carol Jane Moore of the Broome County Doll Club tells their story.
Well, the Dion Quintuplets were born in 1934 when you didn't hear of more than twins or perhaps triplets. These five little babies were born up in the North Woods of Canada. They had no running water. They had no electricity. The first two babies were delivered by a midwife who had delivered the five brothers and sisters, and then they called in the doctor who came to assist in the birth of the other three, and they were kept alive around a wood stove. And eventually, they became the wards of the Canadian government. And from then on, a special hospital was built for them, and they were the the ones that people really were interested in seeing them grow up, and they did all grow up to be young women.
Dolls are usually thought of as playthings, but you can see from this exhibit that they can capture a lot of our heritage. I'm Camille DeWalder, reporting for Action News for Kids.
The doll exhibit we just saw will be on display on the second floor of the Robertson Mansion until December 29th. And we encourage you to take a look for yourself.
A doll can make a good companion for a while, but many kids would agree that nothing beats the company of their own grandma and grandpa. Grandparents always seem to have enough time to talk to us and play with us. They're special because many times they can give us more attention than our parents have time for. A local program called the Foster Grandparents recognizes that kids often do need special attention, and they supply volunteer grandmas and grandpas. Let's take a look.
Have you ever wished that you could take your grandma or grandpa to school with you? Harriet Perry is part of the Foster Grandparents program. She helps out in this classroom at Thomas Jefferson School, even though she's not really related to any of the kids here.
What do foster grandparents do? Well, we do a lot of things. In school, we help the children with their lessons, reading, writing, and arithmetic. I love all the kids, and that is sincere. Everybody benefits from another friend.
The teacher of this classroom, Pat Nesselrode, feels the kids get a lot out of the program.
It's especially helpful for the children that normally don't get individual attention, and she has time to spend with each kid every day.
Don't go away. When we come back, we'll meet a woman who's earned the nickname of Mother Nature. And now, back to Action News for Kids.
Many famous artists are remembered every day by visitors to art museums all over the world. But behind many of the artists whose names we recognize are the people who first encouraged them to develop their artistic talent. Our next story is about the owner of a New York City art gallery who gave many well-known artists their first big chance.
From the outside, it looked like an ugly little building. But behind these walls, art history was made. There weren't many art galleries in Manhattan when Martha Jackson opened this one in 1953, but she made it a success right from the start.
One could see everything there. One could see works of European artists, young Americans, established Americans, American artists who didn't have the celebrity that they would subsequently. And I think that's important to remember, that many of the artists whose names are household words today, by whose careers we reckon the progress of American art, were relatively unknown when she showed them.
Harry Rand has put together an exhibit paying tribute to Martha Jackson at the Smithsonian's Museum of American Art. She was a woman who was not afraid to take risks, and she opened her gallery at the age of 47. Besides displaying the work of very famous artists, she also gave many unknown artists their first big chance.
She showed Louise Nevelson early on. She showed Lee Krasner. She showed Grace Hartigan. She showed black artists like Emilio Cruz, like Bob Thompson. Essentially, her eye was not discriminating by race or gender or age. And although we find that commonplace today, it was extraordinary in her own time.
Martha Jackson was always ahead of her time. She showed pop art before anyone else. And the term op art refers to an exhibit first held at her gallery. She often paid her artists regular salaries so they could paint full time. Owning a gallery was not just a business to her.
She had a motto which she passed on to her son, who subsequently came to head the gallery, which was, if you like something, always buy two of it. One to sell and one to keep.
In memory of his mother, Martha Jackson's son gave 100 works of art from her collection to the Smithsonian. I'm Bethany Gygas, reporting for Action News for Kids.
We've just seen how the art gallery owner in that last story helped many other people to understand and appreciate new kinds of art. Our next story is also about a woman who wants to help other people make new discoveries. But her lessons are about wildlife and the great outdoors, and she's earned the nickname of Mother Nature.
Can you see him? Look across the stream. He paints himself all brown. They give himself two big ears. They're just lying down. They're having their morning nap.
For 30 years, Elizabeth Terwilliger has trooped youngsters of all ages through Marin County, California's majestic redwoods. With children scampering to keep up, she treks miles through the trees and across the beaches, making the same discoveries seem new to a different audience every day.
It's the joy of discovery. You're constantly learning something. What did you see? What did you hear?
Officially, Elizabeth Terwilliger is a volunteer nature guide with the National Park Service. Unofficially, she's Marin County's own Mother Nature.
She has time to talk to you. She makes you understand how to save these birds, how to save wildlife, and not to destroy it.
She was honored at the White House for her work. She used the occasion to show President Reagan how birds fly.
Now be a great blue heron and bring the air to you like this. And it go, ugh.
Her tours are booked well in advance. She's in her second generation of pupils now.
Mr. Banana Slug.
Mr. Banana Slug.
Will you please come out and see us?
Please come out and see
us. Oh, look, make your fingers do this. And he's looking, oh, do you hear that tiny bird?
Yeah.
Elizabeth Terwilliger has plotted the same trails every day for decades. Will she ever quit? No, she says.
But every time you go out, you see something new. The other day, a big seal came up on the beach.
Many people share the same kind of love for nature and can also turn it into jobs or hobbies. Bird watching is a popular pastime, and the man in our next story has not only seen hundreds of different kinds of birds, he's written and illustrated many bird guides for other bird watchers.
When Roger Torrey Peterson started watching birds, people thought he was an oddball. But that was more than 50 years ago, before his field guides transformed a frivolous pursuit into a popular pastime for an estimated 40 million people. Peterson's own obsession with birds, as he calls it, dates from his very first field trip in the seventh grade.
On a tree trunk, about 4 feet from the ground, there was a flicker, this bundle of brown feathers, and I thought it was dead. And he was obviously tired from migration, but I thought it was dead. I touched it on the back, and immediately this bundle of feathers burst into life, and I saw that red flash on the back of the head and the golden wings, and it was like resurrection. And ever since then, birds have symbolized to me the most eloquent expression of life.
Peterson has dedicated his own life to convincing others of the joy of bird watching, and the Smithsonian is celebrating his success this summer with a special exhibition. Trained as an artist rather than a biologist, Peterson developed a whole new way of identifying birds in the field, calling attention to simple differences in pattern or field marks. His first guide, 50 years ago, revolutionized bird watching. Now, more than 20 books later, his own interest has never wavered. Serious birders keep a life list of the species they've seen. Peterson's list includes close to half of the 9,000 species in the world, but even some North American birds still elude him.
Yes, I'm still looking for Bachman's warbler. Someday I'll see it. But I've got to go very fast. If someone reports that, I've got to go there immediately.
Roger Torrey Peterson. At 76, he's now able to devote more time to his first love, painting birds. An exhibit celebrating his lifetime of achievements is on view all summer at the National Museum of Natural History in Washington, D.C.
Still to come, all the big events this week in our kids' calendar, and a look at an unusual car from the past. So don't go...
Action News for Kids.
Some of our favorite landmarks here in Broome County are the old wooden carousels, which can be found at Ross Park, Recreation Park, and several other locations. They're considered quite a treasure because the horses have all been carved and painted by hand, and the old Wurlitzer organs which supply the music are no longer being made. Well, out in California, another one of these old carousels is currently being restored to the working condition. Let's take a look.
Once upon a time, there were thousands and thousands of wooden horses prancing in circles all over America. But for many of them, the music has stopped, the children are gone, and they wait out their days in antique shop windows. That won't happen to these horses in Los Angeles' Griffith Park, though. Not if Warren and Rosemary Deasy have their way. The husband and wife team bought the old carousel with one thing in mind, to keep it going, just as it has for 67 years. It was expensive. They won't say how much, but selling two office buildings helped them finance it. Still, the Deasys think it's worth it.
It's the only business I ever saw where people give you 50 cents for a ride, and when they leave, they say thank you.
The carousel will take a lot of work. Generations of children have worn grooves in the horses by urging them on with their heels. Jewels must be restored to their former glory, and there are missing tails that must be replaced with real ones. About the only thing that needs no attention are the metal horseshoes, but then they don't get much wear. Still, it will take time, maybe 5 years, maybe more.
It's exhausting sometimes being here 14 hours a day, but when you see that little child get on and just kick their legs and squeal with excitement because they're so happy on there, it's worth every tiring hour and every scrimp, every penny, every piece of work.
For the Deasys, it all comes down to making memories. They know merry-go-rounds are good for that, and they want to be sure children are making their own memories here for another 50 years, maybe another 100 years.
The carousels here and in California are a nice part of the past that have continued to be fun today. And in California, some car buyers are getting the kick out of owning a piece of the past. A little car, which wasn't much of a hit in the 1950s, is getting a lot of attention today.
Is this one of the most sought-after cars in Hollywood today? Or this? Nope. The rising king of California auto chic is this smidgen of a car called the Nash Metropolitan. This automotive dinosaur sold in the 50s for about $1,300, and people didn't exactly beat down the doors of Nash dealers to buy one. But time and taste can be fickle, and the Met, as it is called by those who love it, is finally finding its place in the California sun.
Original Mets came in two-tone color combinations in the now hot Miami Vice-style pastels of yellow, turquoise, and pink. Today, a really nice Met like this one can go for as much as $9,000.
In the midst of this Met madness is Jim Valentine, whose North Hollywood shop is a Met owner's heaven. Valentine sells every kind of part and accessory for the proper care of the car with the Art Deco style.
We have rock stars that buy them. We have people in really all walks of life. We have doctors. We have dentists that own them. The thing you find when you drive one of these, which my wife and I do all the time, is that you get a lot of this type of thing. You get a lot of thumbs up, you know, real gusto reactions to the car.
Cartoon artist Bill Frake can afford one of those fancy European cars, but opted for a Met last year.
My wife and I have a blast driving it, and the dog likes riding in it too.
Frake says people may laugh at how his Met looks, but not at how it performs.
If for the first two gears, you can outbeat anybody at the light, which is very embarrassing to everybody.
An estimated 5,000 to 10,000 Mets are still believed to be around, news which comes as a relief to Met addicts who, like some potato chip eaters, can't have just one.
I'd like to get actually about two more.
With the days getting shorter and colder, it might be getting harder for you to stay busy. So here's a few suggestions from our kids' calendar. Bundle up for a late autumn nature walk at the Finch Hollow Nature Center on November 16th at 2 o'clock. Or, for something really different, participate in the gallery games at the Robertson Center. Participants will learn some of the games that were played by the Robertsons and other families in the early 1900s. The program is free and will be held on November 16th and 17th from 3 to 4 p.m.
And finally today, our last story is about the crocodile and how animal lovers are trying to keep them from dying out and disappearing. Because they are often hunted, the number of crocodiles has dropped drastically. Here's that story now.
Baby crocodiles cry just like other infants, but they could hardly be called cute. These are among the rarest animals in the world. Experts believe there may only be about 1,000 Orinoco crocodiles surviving in the rivers of Colombia and Venezuela. Their jungles are being bulldozed and built up in the name of progress. It's feared that the crocodile, a survivor of the dinosaur age, may not survive through the space age.
There's approximately 26 species and subspecies of crocodiles, and all but about five are endangered. And that kind of gives you an idea. It's an animal that can't get up and move out to a new area. And because it's under the total pressure, each animal is slowly disappearing.
But at several zoos around the country, like Miami's Metro Zoo, experts are trying to ensure that this prehistoric reptile will survive. In 1978, this was the first zoo in the Western Hemisphere to successfully breed the rare Siamese crocodile. Since then, these babies have been sent all over the world to other breeding projects.
Yes, with zoos getting interested in breeding crocodiles, they'll stand a better chance. And with governments interested in developing meat markets, they'll stand a better chance because this is one of the animals they may turn to breed for protein.
Could be a future meal.
Possible. Yeah. It would help in, of course, the meat shortage in developing countries, but it would also help the species because if they do that, then you reduce the amount of pressure on the animal in the wild for poachers.
This is a 3.5-month-old Siamese crocodile. Experts believe that they are extinct in the wild. But thanks to breeding programs like this one at Miami's Metro Zoo, it's now believed that these rare animals have a much better chance for survival in the future.
Once again, we'd like to remind you that your ideas could end up right here on the show. If you know something interesting or unusual that would make a good story for us, drop us a line. Write to us at Action News for Kids, WBNG-TV, Box 1200, Binghamton, New York, 13902.
If we use your story on the show, we'll send you an Action News for Kids t-shirt, like the ones we're wearing.
We're out of time for today, but be sure to join us again next week, Friday at 4, when we'll take a look at the Binghamton native who created the TV show The Twilight Zone. His name, Rod Serling.
Till then, have a safe week and a happy one.
The preceding was pre-recorded.